A major discovery was exhibited in Paris towards the end of the 19th century. This was cinema, known as the seventh art. The first film in history made by the Lumière brothers. An astonishing event took place when the film was first projected. The audience fled in panic in the middle of the film. The image of a train approaching a station was so realistic that they imagined the train was about to hit them. This was the first time they had seen a film screen, and they thought that the image produced with a technology that was exceptionally advanced for its time actually represented reality. The audience were deceived by the light falling onto the screen and imagined that the images that formed were real. Another 100 years went by. The same illusory effects are obtained today thanks to holograms and with special eyeglasses that set up a three-dimensional image. People wearing these goggles become greatly excited and imagine that the virtual world they see is actually real. They feel themselves to be part of this virtual universe. Yet they do all this in the full knowledge that these images they see are only virtual. But what about the real world? Could that also be deceiving us with its high technical quality? Could we actually be only imagining that we have direct experience of a world that we perceive virtually? This film looks at the answer to that question. In the light of the latest findings, scientists have arrived at a most interesting conclusion. In fact, our world is pitch black, and what we call light is simply a perception formed in people's brains. Because none of the sources of light actually emit it. What is emitted to the universe from light sources is radiation of different wavelengths and different kinds. In other words, electromagnetic particles. Some of these reach our Earth. Some of these electromagnetic particles, which produce various effects on Earth depending on their volume, mass, velocity, and frequency, are known as light. We perceive the effects of these electromagnetic particles in a variety of ways. Throughout our lives, many radioactive particles enter our bodies and pass through them. Some of these particles are so heavy and energy charged that usually they shatter any molecule they may encounter and continue on their way with little deviation. This phenomenon underlies the way in which radiation gives rise to cancer. Some electromagnetic particles are slightly weaker than these. X-rays, for example. X-ray machines make use of X-rays and turn the effect of electromagnetic radio waves into visible light, that is, into a form visible to our eyes. Some parts of electromagnetic radiation act as a source of the perception we refer to as light. Photons. Photons are much lighter particles that usually bounce back from the first molecule they encounter. In doing so, they do almost no damage to the place they strike. Due to their frequencies, the speed at which they vibrate, ultraviolet rays are charged with greater energy and can penetrate more deeply into our skin, sometimes damaging the cell's genetic codes. That is why we need to be protected from solar rays at certain times, particularly during the summer. Those photons, known as infrared because of their frequencies, leave some of their energy behind, increasing the speed of vibration of the atoms there. In other words, the heat on the surface they strike. For this reason, infrared rays are also called as heat rays. An electric heater, for example, gives off large amounts of infrared radiation, which is seen, or rather perceived, by our bodies as heat. It is clear that photons give rise to many physical and chemical effects, and not all photons are perceived as light rays. Light rays are those whose frequencies lie between infrared and ultraviolet. The only reason we describe these particles as light rays is that they are perceived by our eyes. So how do our eyes perceive these photons? Let us now examine the answer to that question together. The retinal layer at the back of the eyeball contains cells that are sensitive to light. Photons falling on this layer are turned into electrical impulses by the receptor cells there. The optical nerves carry this electrical current to the visual center at the rear of the brain, which interprets the current and gives rise to images. In other words, if the cells in our eyes perceived these photons not as light but as heat, then instead of perceiving an object as red, we would perceive that it was hot. All these findings show that the eye is merely an intermediary unit that converts photons into an electrical signal. No senses of light or color form in the eye. We give the name of a color to photons at various frequencies of vibration. Red, blue, yellow. When all frequencies are combined together, the result is white. In other words, this piece of paper is white because it reflects all photons of different frequencies. This leaf is green because it reflects only those photons at a frequency that gives the impression of the color green while absorbing all others. This box, on the other hand, is black because it absorbs all photons and reflects none. In other words, none of the photons falling on black objects are reflected into the eye. When people refer to a structural disorder in the eye, this actually means that photons are converted into some different electrical signals in the retina. As a result, the visual center in the brain perceives the same object in different ways. That is why colorblind people confuse certain colors with one another and are unable to perceive others at all. These facts show that concepts such as white, green, or transparent are actually perceptions forming in the brain. In other words, they are completely physical phenomena that occur in darkness. The external world that we imagine we see as brightly colored consists of perceptions and interpretations taking place inside that darkness. In fact, there is a three-stage wall between us and the original matter in the outside world. First, we can never see the original of the television we sit in front of, nor what kind of reality it possesses in the outside world. What reaches us is merely photons leaving the television, in other words, physical particles. We can never go beyond these particles. This is the first wall between us and the original television.